All right, we are back. Another session, another week. So we're going to do a quick little recap. Last session was quite productive, although we didn't roll many dice, honestly. I think we had like one or two official dice rolls. There wasn't many beyond that, and they were kind of towards the end. We started off just finalizing any last little bits of stuff in the Badlands, double checking on any little minor details. We asked a few questions, looked at each of the individual parties, people, see what they were going to do, got the gnomes were started back, and etc. Some of the wizards had already left, and then once we were all ready to go, we left the last people that were still too critical to move, but were out of any kind of actual danger of dying. We left the triage center people in control of that. The Archwizard popped us through a portal right into the courtyard of our new castle. From the middle of our new castle, we went on a little tour of the grounds, got an idea of, you know, its defenses, and its kind of still bare bones yet quite functional nature. It was obviously built entirely by Phalanx people that had nothing but defensible ideas in mind, not at all in actually being a useful establishment of commerce and trade and the like. So we had a little ideas on maybe where we might go in the future on that. Just as we were musing through, we had Lodrin build us a little grove of trees tended through the evening. We also had a little night of somewhat fun on the town, as we get at least our first real breathable chance of being people again, functioning without the ever threat of doom and despair right on the cusp of the next corner that we turn around. We kind of got a look of the river and the scope of the land nearby, and kind of an idea of, you know, the way that the kind of government and commerce kind of operate in their own independence. We had some input on ways we can expand on that, particularly with looking at ways to bring new people in, get people excited about the land, and get them conscripted so that they could help rebuild part of the defenses of the area. And as we did so, we kind of spoke with Dardok and several of the other leaders about their roles. We left Dardok as steward, kind of to oversee that, as we also had, say, Lumos people who were going to be returning to the Badlands to start looking for sites at which we can begin doing some tests, maybe to take back the Badlands a little, as well as search out the hidden pockets of their people, kind of gather them and bring them back. Ileana decided that she might join us in the future, but for the short term, she's going to return and get her evening with Nilar, something that she's been looking forward to for a little bit. And while she was there, she would acquire her daughter and Izzy's mom, bring them back to the garrison, and stay in communication through magical means when she would come join us sometime in the future. After we kind of had these conversations, met the staff, we then went down to meet our portal wizard, old, little crazy, as can be somewhat expected from our retired wizard folk at this point. But after he kind of spent quite a bit of energy, it seemed like, warming up the portal to get it ready, we all made it through, entering into the city of Camden, right here on the coast of the country of Camden. Immediately coming through, we got another blast of heat, almost reminiscent of the Badlands, but yet cool breeze, the smell of salt from the air, as the beautiful coastal paradise that is Camden City sprawled out before us. We walked our way into the city itself, into the marketplace, where Bijou saw her father in some kind of pitched argument or strife with a very large gentleman who he was trying to talk down. We made an attempt to interfere, but he shut us down as he resolved the situation, and everyone in the area seemed very calm and soothed. Some kind of magical means by some aura or eminence that he was giving off. The large man who was so, definitely upset. It's what sounded like the loss of his brother on one of the recent expeditions. Eventually went off, and that's where we pick up, right here in the middle of the marketplace. As Bijou's father turns to the party itself.
How long does that calm emotions effect last?
Unknown.
We are definitely still under the influence of it, though, right?
That is correct. Particularly you two that were close. The others that were a little further back, not affected. They did not have the wisdom saves. Only you and Bijou that were kind of making their way forward to get to him, while the others were still lingering pretty far back.
So I'll just turn to Bijou and kind of say, you know, if it wasn't for that vision, I don't know what we'd be doing here. Your father seems very capable.
I smile real big at her because I know that he is. And I'm like, hey, Dad!
You see him kind of cock his head a little bit.
I point to myself and I go, Bijou?
You see him kind of like very bewildered look on his face.
How long has it been since you've seen each other?
A couple decades.
Decades?
He's been very calm. Like, so after his confrontation with this large gentleman, he turned, and he had this very high confidence in the way he was speaking, in his mannerisms. And as he turned, you could see that, you know, the release of this soothing calm kind of resonated, some kind of internal channeling that he is doing. He turns as rather calm. He has this very inquisitive look on his face. And then you kind of feel that soothing calm fade, and as soon as you do, you can see the color of his face turn red, and his brows come up in anger. First, how dare you interrupt? You could have caused irreparable harm in what would have been nothing more than a simple matter. And second, how dare you claim to be my daughter? You are perhaps a passable older sibling, but you, my daughter, you are not.
Hey, man.
I touched her and I'm like, it's okay. Like, don't, it's okay. I got this. I don't have any other siblings. It's just me. And I show him the pen that's on the brooch on my shirt, and I pull out the little trinket in my pocket from my mom, and I show him that, and I'm like, I'm Bijou.
I don't know where you've come across these things. Stolen. Now I must worry for those that are beloved to me.
Well, they worry about you. You've not been home in over 20 years.
Hornswoggle! It wasn't even a year ago that I was home.
Okay.
Where all have you been in the past year?
I was here on this... I want to say lovely, because this town and this place is lovely. This island. I've been here for the better part of a year. Been on a grand adventure. This is three unfortunate excursions into the jungle. And I'm about to make my fourth. This one will be successful.
But you can't. You've got to go back home. They need your help there.
What year do you think it is?
As a meta note, my friends tried to do this in my campaign because they thought they were time traveling. Do we even know what year it is? And is there even a like year for Ralidar?
There is, and it does follow the Forgotten Realms calendar as well. I don't know for sure what year it is. I'll have to look at the current timeline on, I think it's like 18 something, BD or whatever, and I forgot, what is
it? How old's Luma? It's in the year blah blah blah, Luma. Time started at Luma's birth.
His first birth or his second birth?
Good question. What do you have after death and before death?
Okay, so let's see. So the current year in actual Forgotten Realms is 1494 DR. And so we all know as in character that it would be 1494 DR. Okay, so we have that established.
Mm-hmm.
Why, it's 1475, of course.
How long were you in the jungle? It must have been a long time. It's 1494.
You haven't been to the Feywild, have you?
The Feywild? No. An illustrious place that I wish to return to someday. But I haven't been since I was a child.
So what year is it? 1475, is that what he said?
It is 1475. I still have 19 years, according to the contract with my wife. Or rather, 9 years. Sorry, 9 years.
I'm not sure I was even born then. Is he, like, trying to math?
So you just recently gave me my little trinkets of the little raven and the little wolf?
I gave them to my daughter, maybe 8 to 10 months ago.
That was nearly 20 years ago.
Preposterous.
Lodrin's gonna stride up to him and kind of lean down and look at him, get like his face right up and face to face with him.
Which is humorous, given that you're more than twice as tall as he is.
Yes.
You would even pass as an advisor. The color is wrong. The scent is definitely different. Nope. Amateur illusionists will not trick me this day.
Ask her something only your daughter would know.
Listen to me as you have before. I've walked lands, floated seas, over 200 years. People who live together in their large cities sometimes measure things time-wise more differently than I do. But believe me, this is your daughter, and there has been much more time that has surpassed than you know.
But that makes no sense. I can see the genuineness of your eyes. And I know that you tell no lie. But the words you say could be nothing but false. Because it simply makes no sense.
I've always known you to have more wisdom than a man who would just ignore something he couldn't fathom.
Many things to ponder. He kind of turns to look at Bijou. You sure have her hair.
Not much we can do about that. She shakes her head and it goes kind of crazy.
But you're a beautiful young adult.
And I've seen many things.
When I'd left, you hadn't even come of age.
Yeah, you missed that. It was a grand party. You would have enjoyed it.
He just kind of shakes his head, you know, with a little solemn look and his head a little hanging down. I don't know what to say.
Say you sit down and eat, is it breakfast time or lunch time? Whatever time it is, you have a meal with us?
It's probably coming up on lunchtime, yeah. It was still morning when we, it was just late morning when we went through the portal. So, I mean, wasn't too long of a trek into the town, into the middle, to find the actual market square. I suppose that would be prudent.
Yeah, especially these guys back here get grumpy if they don't eat. She points to all of her friends behind her.
Maybe we can make sense of it all. And so, he's going to take a few steps forward and just grab you up in a big hug. Of all the things lost, time is the worst.
There's a little tear in her eye, but she just hugs him back really hard. So where's good to eat?
I've rented out an inn for a day or two until I can gather my things.
Of course you have.
A whole inn, too, right? That wasn't a...
Oh, yeah. No, it's an entire inn.
Well, let's go.
You must tell me of what has transpired these amounts of time that have lapsed. If you kind of look, and so as you look at him, you know, he has aged throughout the years from, you know, each of his trips comes back and you've noticed some amount of age to him. You really expected, even though gnomes live longer than humans, that even across 20 years there should be some subtle signs of aging. But you don't notice any. He looks exactly like the last time that you saw him when you parted ways not long ago. Or not long ago for him. It wasn't that long ago, rather.
So as we walk to the inn, I'm like, you know, you should send Mom some of that cream, whatever you're using.
Cream?
Yeah, you look the same. Mom would like that.
You still have to forgive me. It doesn't seem as though it has really been that long. Even our reunion, as both happy and sad as it may seem to be, We can't let it detract from the importance of what lies ahead.
It's always true.
Can I ask what it is you're here looking for?
You can see that he's like, kind of quiets for just a moment as he looks around very cautiously. Perhaps when privacy is more assured. And
of course.
He leads you on towards a very large inn that's like 3 stories tall and very fancy. You can tell as you walk in that this is an upper crust kind of place, and he's rented the whole building for his stay here.
The whole walk, I'm like skipping and very lighthearted. And when I see the inn, like I get really excited because it's something really nice. We haven't had that in a while. I started like grinning. My smile is as big as my face is.
As soon as you walk through the door, servants come straight to attention, bustling about, even though there's no other patrons about. There is a large number of support staff. For just him and whoever else he might have as a part of his endeavor. Walks in, he orders a couple of drinks, kind of moves over to a large table in the middle. And sit, let us order some food, let us drink. And then he stops and he begins to cast a spell.
Do I know what it is?
Yeah, you can recognize that it is one that is a barrier to sound. Similar to the silence spell, but rather than being silence within the bubble, it's a barrier so that noise can't come in and out. I think it's reasonably safe to talk now. Don't worry about the servants. We have a little arrangement. The spell covers their ears as well. They'll walk around deaf as a post, at least for the time being.
That's pretty fancy.
It is. Well, so this is Izzy, and this is Dean, and this is Carr, and this is Lodren.
Hello.
And that guy over there, well, don't worry about him.
You tell me not to worry about him. Now I can't help but worry about him.
His name's Lumo. He's on a different quest. He's just here because he has to be.
I see. Well, business or otherwise, this is who you've surrounded yourself to take care of you in your travels?
Well, it's more of like divine intervention. You see, Lodren and I left and on a quest to come find you because... You know, Mom was getting worried. You've been gone so long. And we happened to run into these people, and they kind of saved us from some bandits. And then we met this wizard guy, and we went through some things that were unpleasant, and I showed him the scar on my side from the sandworm. And so we found out that we were all supposed to work together to save the whole world or something, and I think we've done that, or at least for now it's quieted down, and so we could come talk to you.
I see.
They didn't quite run into us.
Things have been stirring in the Badlands.
Well, there was some indication that your father may be part of it too, although the main danger is over for now.
You can see him get a pretty noticeable frown on his face. He couldn't help but butt into all matters that were not his own. Not surprised.
Who?
Who's he?
My father.
He passed away.
I wouldn't put it past him to figure a way to meddle anyway.
I'm sorry, we've sort of been introduced, but I'm afraid I didn't actually catch your name, sir.
My daughter didn't even have the courtesy to present the name of her father to her compatriots.
Well, we're not so formal.
She always called you Dad.
I see. This is a little bit of a disappointed kind of sound. For her, at least, it may have been some time, but I have not forgot my manners entirely. I am Capricious Fenyon.
And how do you spell that, DM? Ah, thank you.
With the extra, I put an extra in. Whoops.
You did. It's okay.
Okay, let's start over.
Very well. I think it important with your world-saving endeavors, as much as I'd like to hear that story, how far-fetched it may be, particularly with my young little one, being at its head seems far-fetched.
It does. But it happened.
Let me begin by telling you a bit of a story. Of history's past. And then as he kind of stands up and begins to speak, you can see his motions are rhythmic. The lights, the candles, even the little oil lanterns dim a little. And they seem to, when he puts accent on certain words, they seem to flare with a little brightness as he begins to tell a story. Some time ago, Ao was displeased with the route that his gods were taking. So, he chose a representative. Each in turn was given a controlling orb, power to affect the way the progression of Ralidar would unfold. But he made sure, with the powers as high as they were contained within, that could defy even the gods themselves, could not be powered by the immortal. Only the mortals, in their true will to shape Ralidar in the way they wished, had such ability. 5 of these orbs he made, each in turn was given to a champion of each of a greater deity personifying the 5 points, the 5 pillars, the 5 tenets. Long ago has it been since these orbs have been a factor. The gods ward this land. You speak of the Badlands. Some of the culmination of that war are wrought in the very existence of that evil place. This predates even that, but they sought the power. To Mystra, he gave the Orb of Law. To Poseidon, he gave the Orb of Chaos. To Lathander, he gave the Orb of Good. To Shar, he gave the Orb of Evil. And to Agma, he passed along the key, the Orb of Balance. You can imagine that wielding, even through their champion, such power would be the envy of other gods. And as one also might imagine, Lord Sirik, the master of deceit and lies, the anarchist, could not stand that there were power both above and below, tipping the balance against his efforts, well, to undo all. So he killed Poseidon. He took his trident, and he took his orb. That death, and the subsequent chaos that ensued, spiraled Ralidar into near oblivion. With the help of Pelor, Ao sought out to wrench those things from reality. Most have been lost since the day after Sirik's orb was taken from him. It was destroyed, tipping the cosmic balance. And as such, the Orb of Law was lost to man, as Ao's balance to the scales. This island housed a tower, much like that outside of Rodrin City. It was the prominence of Mistra's rule of law here in Ralidar. It held back the dark. It held back the things from below. It kept the world in balance. And then that balance faded. The tower lost and disappeared, and hasn't been found since. But there's tale of a lich, one that had been drawing great power, making dark deals with all of those evil, vying for the ability to find it. Many people feared that this would come to pass, and they've been looking. For the last hundreds of years, the wizards, even some of the wizards of old, brought back by Mistra to locate her missing orb. I think I have found clues as to where it's at. And that's why I'm here. And that's why I keep making journeys into the jungle. This fourth expedition, this must be the one. We almost had it, or at least we thought we were getting near the last time when we were set on by wild elements, we'll say, that did not wish us to succeed, thinking we had intruded on their lands. Several of my crew near died in the effort for us to escape, but we made it back. But I've hired new crew that will see us done. And we will be there. And we will succeed. And with that, like, the lights kind of come back to normal.
Steen is just enthralled in the presentation.
Mm-hmm. Well, how do you know this crew's going to make it? How are they qualified?
Well, battle-tested for sure. I've hired many from many walks of life. They will join us. They come at a mighty expense. That's how I know.
Izzy kind of looks at her fingernails and she's like, have you thought about hiring somebody who's slain a demon lord?
Or, you know.
A demon lord? Wow. That would be a mighty feat if such a thing existed.
Bijou smiles at Izzy.
Wasn't it two, or are we not counting the first one because he was desummoned for the second one?
Well, no, that was the devil.
Oh, the devils, sorry. So yeah. Confusing.
So Bijou's like looking at everybody, like all of her friends, and she's like trying to get a feel for what they're thinking.
Izzy mostly still looks pretty mellow.
My eyes are big. Like, that was the coolest presentation.
You can definitely tell that no matter your own personal thoughts on the actual subject, he has a very powerful command and allure, and very convincing. Even if you have no idea or complete disbelief about what he may be saying and its truth, it is still compelling. Something you notice right away.
So, I know some people that are pretty qualified. She looks around at her friends. But what clues do you have to know where this tower is?
Ah. So Lord Ogma, the keeper of the Orb of Balance, has a book, as does Lord Sarek. But Ogma's book is blank. And this blank book does contain secrets that are only revealed to those in desperate need of them. I've seen this book. It's held in a Maoran temple. They revere it because of its implication. And there I saw the truth. Hidden in a valley of the lost, the wizard's tower still stands. The orb, contained within, as well as its ruler, trapped.
A wizard's tower?
Indeed.
Hey, like we've done one of those before.
Like Rotogras?
Similar. The new one was constructed nearly 1500 years ago when the first was lost. Much as Rodrin is today, was this isle very similar.
So, your plan is to get the orb?
The older one is easier to get into.
I doubt very much that it'll be an easy endeavor. The wizards never much liked people to enter their buildings.
No, of course not. Wiles build them pitiful finger waggers.
Technically, they wanted us to get into the last one, too.
If we can find the valley, we can find the tower. If we can gain entrance, maybe we can figure out a way to release the seal. Perhaps let Master Mordenkainen out of his cage, and the power of the orb with it. to bring balance once again.
On your previous expeditions, did you come across anything odd in the jungle?
There's a lot of oddness. Mostly the wild, savage nature that is these lands, and their inhospitable inhabitants. I think we found the entrance to the valley, but we were ambushed on our last expedition.
By what?
An entire clan of orcs. And a clan of hobgoblins working together.
Working together? Doesn't that seem unusual?
Yes.
Possibly working for the same master?
To my knowledge, those two races have been in a blood war. A feud that has lasted centuries. They each carved their own hovel out of a piece of this land, and they care not for one another, as there is war ever ongoing between them.
I lean over and poke Izzy in the ribs and I say, how do you feel about an adventure, Izzy?
She kind of froze her brow and hesitates for a second. She's like, I'm not sure how I feel, actually. I don't know. Sounds fine.
She looks at Steen and Carr and Lodrin. Like, she's not gonna volunteer everybody, like, she's just gonna wait for their say it's okay. But you can tell, like, she wants you guys to say something that you guys wanna go to.
Well, I mean, Lodrin, I'm
just gonna kinda look taken back and a little surprised. I suppose everyone else are the only family I have left. And we're all wrapped up in whatever this is becoming. It's like we are the only ones that can stop what is happening or repair what has been done.
She jumps up and hugs Lodrin around his neck. Or as close as she can get. With him sitting in a chair.
I mean, I got nothing else to do. Might as well just go on adventure.
So what do you say, Lemo? You want to look for one of the balls that Paylor's looking for?
It's one way to get him interest.
I'm sure if he was here, he would have been pretty all ears on this.
Yeah, particularly the part about, you know, the mortals wielding the power of the orbs and the gods cannot. And in ways it rivals or surpasses the power of the gods themselves. Like, immediately gears are probably turning in his head of ways at which he can utilize such an opportunity.
So, Sirik no longer has the Orb of Chaos, correct?
That's what, according...
From the story that we got?
According to the story, that's correct.
Sounds like that's why they blasted the Badlands, was to take it away.
I guess I'm sort of, saying this to the group. If Law is opposite of Chaos, and the Chaos Orb is gone, and the Law Orb is found, that may get Paylor's attention very quickly, or Aeol's attention even.
it would be a threat to the balance. Or at least it seems that way.
In particular, you do know that one thing he did say in his story was specifically that Sirik was the one looking for it, too.
Did that lich have a name? Did you ever run across a name of that? I say that almost to Capricious.
The lich.
Just the lich. My notes say lich, period. Fucking lich, period.
There are rumors. Nothing is written for certainty. That perhaps it's a remnants of that which was cast from the wizard's clutches in the last purge. Just over 100 years ago.
Yes, we are familiar with one lich in particular.
If those rumors are true, his name would be Edelmar.
Is the calm emotion still affecting me?
It is not, no.
Oh, okay. That changes a lot of things. So, in that case, she's gonna, like, just, like, white knuckle grip on her sword at the mention of his name.
What do you know of the Witchwood? As that place came up in your readings.
The Witchwood. Far to the west. It lies on the other side of the Hobgoblins' territory. It's a dark place. Even those savage beasts don't enter. There's apparently some powers there that linger, that scare even the orcs and the kobolds and the Yanti and the hobgoblins.
Izzy's gonna take out her map and unroll it onto the table and put a couple of tankards down to hold it.
And I would think since Lumo knows how to use maps now, he would like point at something. Oh, it's right here.
Izzy would ask Capricious if he can show her where he's been so far.
Okay. Yeah. So. On the actual Ralidar world map that I think we got open here, I will put a couple of places. Kind of mark that let me do it with some pointers so that they stick around. Camden City.
And that's where we are now?
That's right. Yep. This is the great gate in the Great Wall. First expedition followed this path. the second expedition, they followed this path. The third expedition, they went straight for the border between, he calls it the corner, between the Savage Lands and each of the realms of the orcs and the hobgoblins. And he thought, this is where he's kind of says, I think I've found the path. But as soon as we reached the corner, we were beset by clans from both races. Heroic sacrifice allowed some of us to escape, and we barely made it back.
And how long did each of these expeditions take you?
The first was the longest. We were gone for 6 weeks. I actually spent a good bit of time safe. It's relatively so. We were unhindered. We explored a good bit of the ridge into the Savage Lands, as that is where I think our clue... That's where I think it leads. Along our trek, we hit the ridge, and we followed it back and forth and back and forth, trying to scour for the hidden path to the Lost Valley. To no avail. Till the supplies ran thin, and were no longer sustainable, we returned. The second, we were only gone 2 weeks. We followed the ridge all the way to the cape, to where the cape meets the wall. We found no path.
Just as an aside, given the distances that he's talking about, do these times make sense to me?
Relatively so, yeah. I mean, okay. They're actually, it's probably longer than it would actually take to travel that kind of distance. I mean, it shouldn't take quite even that long, but if they were in long wagon trains and they were slow going, and once they got to a destination, they then followed up and down and actually spent a good deal of searching, you know, and any kind of searching pattern, that's probably where the bulk of their time was spent, not as much on the actual trip itself.
Right.
The last. We were on the other side of the wall for just over a week and a half. We'd barely made headway to the ridge. We just started looking. I had some clues that I thought we were going in the right direction. And then we were ambushed.
Does that time make sense to me?
I mean, as far as the actual journey goes, I mean, we're probably only a couple of days distance one direction. It's almost from the wall to the ridge is not much further than it is between garrisons. Maybe as far as two garrisons, if they're, you know, looking at the closer ones, as far as relative distance goes, which is about a couple of days for the messengers to go back and forth, scouts to go from one garrison to another, couple of days. So if they spent a couple of days on easy road to get to the wall, a couple of days there, a couple of days back. I mean, it's probably an actual week's journey there and back with no interruption, maybe 8 days. So a couple more days for searching. Yeah, seems reasonable anyway for timeline. At least the time as he perceived it.
Do you have anybody that came back with you this last time?
Yeah, I'm thinking that too, maybe.
You know, your right-hand man or whatnot?
Yes, I have several. We have our mercenaries that are here in town. They're out gathering supplies as we intend to head out tomorrow. They're gathering our new mercenaries as well, as we tend to be successful, even should we be set with ambush again.
I'm kind of curious what time they all think it is. And if there's someone that maybe was just hired from the last expedition. Like, what time do they... Yeah. I'm just wondering if he got back 20 years ago, or if he just actually got back today from the last expedition. Or 19 years.
He says that they should arrive shortly. They should be due back, particularly after they've gathered all those that he had requested.
So those orcs and hobgoblins that pushed you back, was there just kind of grunt troops? Was there any magic?
Mild acts of shamanism did exist, but we were able to shut that down.
The only time travel thing I know Carr would be somewhat about is the Feywild, just because of some of his Elvish ancestry and the Kragan Elvish ancestry, and he knows that could be a bit of a time dilation between that, but I don't think, other than that, he really knows, assuming me do a roll of any type of time displacement magic, especially something of that long. So I guess I'll convey to the group that I feel Capricious may have been very close to something, for something to use so much power as to throw him 20 years off the target.
Could it be something like a proximity to the tower itself? If it was supposed to be lost to mortals, that would be one way to do it. Not that I know anything really about magic, but...
You can see that Capricious is, taking in the conversation. Some level of curiosity. The controlling orbs do have such a power. But one would think that mere proximity would be a dead giveaway for that power.
Well, you didn't seem to be aware of it. No offense.
Well, perhaps not for me, but if I ever survived and returned anywhere, it would become quite evident. He thinks back. Interesting. I did find it odd that the inn had been sold during only a few weeks on an expedition. They were quite prosperous. It makes little sense to sell such a functioning and prosperous inn as this.
Has this inn changed hands, just out of total curiosity, has this inn changed hands at all since I've known the city? Is that a thing I would know about?
Hit me a history check.
That would only be like 7 years, maybe.
As far as you know, this is a pretty fancy inn, and it's a good place to find, you know, maybe a mark or to get work or some of the like. So it's been prominently used, especially even, you know, it's like maybe when the captain would land, how it might be a way to, you know, puff of his chest and show how good he is at his endeavors by staying at such a nice establishment. So this is a place that you're aware of. And as far as you know, it hasn't changed hands.
I lean over to Steen and it's like, I want to send Dardock a good letter before we leave, just in case it's a while until we get back.
I'll just kind of give a meaningful look to the party and kind of tap my necklace and say, I could ask if there's any way that we may be able to counteract something like that, or I don't know.
I mean, it could hurt to have a plan, just in case.
Last thing I would want is to go into the jungle and come back out to find out everything's happened without us. There's still, even if Edelmar is in here somewhere and also affected by any kind of time weirdness, there's still a handful of others out there that we need to look out for. Oh, ew. Izzy just kind of stands up and steps back from the table a little bit.
What's wrong?
Nothing. I'm sure they've cleaned it since then. It's fine. Nasty old pirate, and she kind of just grins.
I love inventing the things that your sword's saying from just hearing from what you say. Because at first I thought maybe he told you to get it on with Bijou's dad.
No.
Yeah, I mean, I feel capricious. You may have been very close to something, and that's, we'll put some feelers out to some of the people we know, but that's probably the way we should go. Just gonna have to take some risk with the timeline.
I'm gonna get some more rum. I think I need to get that image out of my head. I walk out of the sound bubble.
As soon as you do, you can hear, it's a very strange effect, as it was kind of deadpan silence that you hadn't really realized was there. As you go through the bubble, you immediately hear kind of an uproaring effect of, as even the sounds of the city nearby kind of overwhelm you a little. Just because of how silent it was on the inside, that you really just hadn't realized until now.
Izzy wishes for the first time that she knew how to do magic. That seems like it would be a very handy spell to have for a thief.
So yeah, as soon as you pop through on the other side, the servants kind of rush up and take your order.
Yeah, just a glass of rum.
Like a little shot glass, or make it a double?
Yeah, you know, two fingers. She holds up her index finger and her pinky finger.
Very well. They scramble over, pull off what looks to be a quite aged bottle off of a shelf from way up top, as they only serve the best stuff.
Nice.
Yeah, hands it over.
How much would I know to give them for that?
You kind of start digging around, maybe start even begin to, you know, grab your coin purse, and then they wave you off. All has been taken care of. Arrangements have already been made.
Uh-oh. She kind of grins and looks back over at the table, like, really?
In the back of my head, I think, like, what if he rented this place out, left for 20 years, was like, I want to rent this place out until I get back, and came back, and, like, he's going to get his bill?
Oh, no.
He's going to sell his country.
I'll just give them a gold piece and say, consider this a tip, then.
Kind of bow, take it, not wanting to push the issue.
And then, since I seem to get some agreement, I will try and use my necklace to contact Arden.
Okay.
And basically, launch in with, I don't know if you are able to see or hear any of that through the spell, or if you're still able to look in on us at all. But I have some questions if you can help.
Unfortunately, I don't know what you mean. I can look from time to time, but it is diminished and small. At least for now. I can feel the faith, even yet returning strength and powers I once had. It just can't affect Ralidar all too much. But please, ask away.
So she'll, all in her head, because she doesn't want anybody else to hear. But she's gonna give him like the Cole's Notes version of what we just went over. And ask specifically about the time difference thing, if there's any way to try and guard against that.
Yeah. So first, he's going to immediately say, you almost hear, like, as you're kind of going through these things, almost like a gasp of, oh dear. Syrinscape should not have been one of those still able to stir the pot to his level. Not yet.
Well, he was apparently the one who sent the Kraken after us, so... I'm not sure he listens too much to any rules of what he should be able to do or not.
No, if there's anyone to cheat, it would be him. To cheat, to lie, to steal. Powers that don't belong to him. To kill when necessary. As long as it ends in the result of tearing everything apart. He somehow finds a way. Damn. What a time to be without my ability.
Well, that's why you have us.
Now this... time dilation. This is very strange. This is one way which the effects that we weren't able to perceive could come to be. You say the bard mentioned Ogma's book and Lord Mordenkainen? Interesting.
Yeah. Did you know him?
From before my time. A previous champion. Renowned, even yet. Has been lost. Thought. Presumed. Lost in more ways than just... dead on the material plane. As his spirit never returned to Mistra's realm. This would make sense of it, if he's been trapped for all this time. If the orb actually still exists, my lady doesn't believe it to be the case. She presumed it destroyed like Syrinx.
Well, it seems that may not have been quite true. But lost in time would certainly make it hard to track.
Indeed. I obviously can't assist you, but mortal power is what fuels the orbs. Their strength of will, the preservation, their mortality, and the virulent vitality that comes from it. That's how they work. And as such, I, even with my ill-perceived powers, are still somewhat immortal. Even Nalar, now champion, has ascended beyond. But, if you had a way to message him, a way that he could be brought in the loop. Or something in the tower he could retrieve that could counteract that effect. Mortal magic. Not that divine through Mistra or the weave itself, but developed by actual mortals through their own power of will.
Something in Rotogras?
Indeed.
I may have a way to contact him indirectly. Thank you. You are a great help as always.
Be well, my champion. And like the last thing he says is kind of fades as he leaves and is gone.
Izzy picks up her rum and goes back into the bubble.
And immediately, like, it's almost shocking how just the sound is gone again. As you kind of come in, you can only hear the sounds that are immediately, you know, emanating from people talking and moving chairs and those kinds of things. But all that outside static ambient noise, gone.
What's everybody else doing at this point?
I would have been happy to fill in Cap with any details that he's missed in the last 20 years at Taft.
That's nice.
Eagles won the Super Bowl.
the Browns won a game.
more like we were over in my cobalts and I learned how to heal people and
maybe
about my coming of age.
He would inquire about your mother.
She's doing well. Well enough, I suppose. I haven't seen her in a little while. But she misses you. She's always brighter when you're home.
It's a shame I must leave her. It's a shame even more that so much time has passed. At least for her.
I mean, she makes on well enough, and you know, my uncle Constant was always good to give her duties, and his wives never wanted them anyway. You know, she's still treated like family, even though you're not home.
He just nods.
I know when I left, she was training new people and her healing techniques that she's learned.
It's excellent news to be both productive and loved. It's important.
After all of this, and I know all of this is no small thing, but after all of this, would you go home?
They need you at home.
If we're successful and survive, I fear, especially with the time lost, the return trip. But look forward to its eventuality. So, kind of trying to lift out of the somber tone, you can see that he kind of forcibly puts himself into a mood of, somewhat cheer, and very similar to the soothing nature before, just him being in a now more upbeat nature, seems to also kind of give you some lively energy, just kind of channeling off of his lead in that regard. Very well. Well, I'm going to leave tomorrow. This time will be successful.
We're going to leave tomorrow.
We'll come with you.
Of course. I also may have some useful news. I need to speak to Nalar, but he may have something that will help us with the time issue.
Wonderful. And especially kind of looking over at Bijou a little. And you feel like you're up for the risks that are ensued by such a journey. The dangers, potentially even combat death of our allies. But treasure and reward and safety should we succeed.
You'll find your daughter has grown into a lion.
So at this, like, him, like, doubting, like, my ability to fight, like, I cast Bigsby's hand.
I'm blessing the background, like Johnny Bravo.
You see that he's kind of taken aback.
And I use it to kind of push him towards me, or his chair towards me, using the forceful hand.
I see.
I think we can handle it.
He kind of turns to Lodrin. It seems as you've acted as more than a tutor. Perhaps I should be mad at you for putting my daughter in such harm's way, as to have learned such skills. He kind of gives Lodrin this little bit of a stare down.
Bijou just bursts into laughter. She thinks this is hilarious that he's getting on to Lodrin.
I would really like to see a gnome staring down Lodrin. It's almost like people. Go ahead.
My heart smiles to know that you were not there to see what happened to your people in the Badlands, and that you will never know.
And that, a mention of that, like, my face is not happy at all. Like, I was waiting till later to tell him about that. Like, I'm not happy and laughing anymore.
So Lodrin's what, like 8 feet tall? 10 feet tall? I probably kind of forget exactly where he fits in that scope.
Yeah, I think he's 8'5".
I think the quote was, as tall as you can be and still be a medium creature.
So Bijou's, what, a little over 2 feet tall? Like, just barely, barely two, a little over 2 feet tall? And Capricious is about the same. So, yeah, he's not just more than double, he's nearly four times as tall as Capricious is. Doesn't come up to his knee, hardly. But yeah, he is given the sternest stare down. It's even somewhat intimidating. I suppose it's your fault. She always one who is strong-willed and do what she wished. Even at the behest of those who knew better.
She bites her lip and is like, doesn't want to make eye contact with him.
Be proud of your daughter. Without her, we wouldn't have made it this far.
Izzy nods emphatically at that.
Oh, that warms my heart. Perhaps on our journey you can take time to relay these tales. I'd be happy to hear them. Regale me of tales of my heroic kin.
I will leave that up to her. I'm no storyteller.
about this time, the door to the inn opens. And a couple of grizzled, large gentlemen walk through. And you can see that Capricious kind of turns, and he snaps his fingers as the sound bubble around you fades. As the roar of the city around kind of crashes in upon everyone. Aha! Captain and my compatriots, come. Meet some others that'll join us on our journey. How goes the selection of the mercenaries that should have arrived? And you can see this big, burly human guy, who's very tall for a human, but also built like a refrigerator, kind of walks over, and he's got a little bitty hat on, and he takes his hat and kind of crumples it up in one hand and holds it down kind of at his waist a little in front of him as he bows a little. I'm sorry, boss. They didn't come. What do you mean they didn't come? Well, the dock guy says ain't nobody been ordered to come. Not since he's been there. Not for a long time. That makes no sense. It wasn't a week ago. Surely not more than two. Yeah, I mean, I saw you put it in, boss, but, he didn't get it. I see. Well, I suppose you then scoured to see who else would come along? We got a handful of people. We paid them just like you said. They're coming along. Might not be what you're looking for. But it's the best we got, boss. So you see Capricious disappointment on his face. Kind of turns to you at the table. It seems as though your offer of help might be more welcome than I had originally anticipated.
Yay!
I see as though you, you know, could hold your own, as tale would tell. I gladly accept your offer. Donation of services for the good of the world.
Seems like that's what we're used to being paid in.
He just kind of gets a really big wink.
But hey, if it's open bar, I mean...
Drink, eat, go for a swim, enjoy your time, for at dawn, I leave.
We leave.
It smiles very well. We leave. Do you think you can talk to your friend and get us that safeguard that we need by then?
I sure hope so.
I wouldn't want to delay now, so be firm.
I will go call immediately.
Excuse me. Oh, you need me to try to send a message to him?
Oh, yeah, you can do that directly. That, yes. Can we do that?
If he's on another realm, I don't know if he would be. It's a smaller, has a slight chance for failure, but...
Well, if it doesn't work, I have a backup, but direct would be better if we can.
What does he need to know?
There should be an item somewhere in Rotograz that will help us counteract the time dilation effect. I think that's what Arden called it. And that we need that as soon as possible, if he can get it for us.
Okay, well, I will, I'll send the message. Rotograz, is that how it's pronounced?
Yes, yep.
In tandem with Izzy, need item from Rotograz to stop time dilation. Could use it as soon as possible.
Roll me a D100.
Ooh, roll a big dice?
Huh? Well, that's like all the ones I was rolling earlier added together still didn't even hit 59, so that's...
I mean, you're above 50%, so I mean, that's good.
It's definitely better than the 8s and 4s we were rolling earlier.
Yeah, it was bad. Had to roll the Will Wheaton out of them. Yeah, if on a different plane, it's a 5% chance, unless it's just in the rough.
Ileana was pretty insistent that she was going to see him tonight, so I imagine he's probably on this plane. Or at least he will be before the evening.
Oh, he's got his hands full.
I don't know, you know, sometimes I feel like I'm on a different plane.
I will say a message was received. He'll get back to us.
Is he okay?
I'm not sure. I'm sure he will be. He's not alone.
Oh. She did not waste any time.
Had nothing to ruin the mood like a big burly Kragan voice in your head.
Burly.
Probably get that to us. I think we'll be okay.
Okay. I'm sure he'll find us before we get there anyway.
Perhaps we should just, we get up at dawn, but take the rest of the afternoon and evening to enjoy paradise in whatever way we see fit. I think we've earned that.
Izzy gets a mischievous smile at that.
Dawn. Be ready at dawn.
Right. That's real early. Okay.
It's afternoon, right?
Yes.
Yeah, it's still plenty of time though.
Yeah, I mean it was by the time you made it over to the inn and had your little sit down and you have lunch, it's storytelling time, a little back and forth. I mean it's still early afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
So, we will then doodly-doop, if you will, through carnal fun and festivities through the evening, knowing that later in the afternoon, a package was delivered, not by Nilar himself, but by another wizard from the tower, left at the inn for when you return. In it is a pendant with the many-pointed star of Mistra. With a note that explains how to use it, and that its presence should ward off any ill effects. And then we're going to take a break, and we'll come back in a little bit, and we'll pick up at dawn. At dawn, we plan.
Not early.
Time you want us back, Chief?
Let's make it 15 after.
Sounds good.
Okay.